McNutt. Welcome to room 136 in the Allen Lab here at the University of Reading Archaeology Department. Today we're going to be doing a co-production between the Museum of English Rural Life and the Archaeology Department called Object Photogrammetry for Beginners. This will be a three-part video lesson series. In this video, we're going to be discussing what is photogrammetry and how the camera settings work. And then in the second video, we will be actually taking photos. So before we get started with anything else, I think we need to define what is photogrammetry and how does it work? Now, the type of photogrammetry we are using is digital photogrammetry called SFM, which is structure from motion photogrammetry. Now, I'm sorry, I will be getting a little bit into technobabble, but I won't go over too much stuff. I won't go over any equations or mathematics or detailed things about algorithms, but I would suggest that you do a bit more reading up on the more technical aspects of photogrammetry, because it will help you later on when you start to go on to more advanced forms and to experiment. I'm gonna handily put up some definitions on the screen here so you can follow along. Structure from motion photogrammetry is just the next generation of digital photogrammetry, which has been around for decades. The basic principles are the same as old-timey stereogram viewers because it uses stereo optics, which has been around since the beginning of photography. But what separates SFM photogrammetry is that the previous generation of algorithms required either a pre-calibrated camera or an additional set of photos to calculate a calibration for the camera. SFM photogrammetry not only determines the camera's position and orientation, but the camera's calibration. Through a repeated cycle of operations, the software hones the accuracy of the virtual scene, which represents the space containing the object. The software creates the virtual space and the object by moving around the object, taking images at set intervals. There needs to be at least a 60% overlap between the images for the software to understand that they go together. Now this translates to rotations of about 15 degrees as shown here. The eye is moving around the object, creating a circular loop. Now the camera rotations are not just a circular loop. They go up and over the object with an ever-increasing downward angle as they go, until you reach the very top, where you then take direct shots downwards at your object. Sometimes you also need to take images slightly under the object to gain better alignment, which I'll be showing in the next chapter. Just so you can see this translated from a two-dimensional drawing into a three-dimensional space, this is the alignment of images taken of an object as seen in the software. Each square represents an image, which then creates a dome. The software looks for matching points that are shared between images. These matching points are used to correlate points in space that form the three-dimensional model. A matching point is created by the software by identifying pixel neighborhoods, or as I like to call them, happy pixel neighborhoods. They are a pixel surrounded by all its closest friends that create distinct groupings that can be registered by the software. The matching points are the key to the creation process. If you look at this diagram, you can see that the matching points create a line of sight from the camera to the point in space. The differences between the lines of sight of the images is what the 3D information is derived from. This is known as parallax. As I mentioned in the beginning of this video, photogrammetry uses stereo optics. Photogrammetry relies on what is called stereo pairs, which is based on the principles of stereopsis. This is where our brain extracts depth cues by comparing information we see in the right versus the left eye, as our individual eyes can only see in two dimensions.
Stereo image pairs are a set of left and right eye images, which you can see here. These images, when then put together, make a stereogram. This is an image that gives you the perception that it is in three dimensions. The software recreates this process with the images you take being used as stereo pairs.
Okay, now that we've gone over all those diagrams and big words, what does this all boil down to? What does it mean, and how does it affect how you take your photographs? And it comes down to one word, precision. It's all about precision. So there's really two factors of this precision. The first is that the camera angles and positioning is key to getting an accurate model. And number two is the quality of the images need to be sharp so the software can read all those little happy pixel neighborhoods and get a better matching of points, helping align the photos and get a detailed texture.
Suggested and useful lens to use for standard photogrammetry is a fixed wide-angle lens or a standard lens. A wide-angle lens ranges from 14mm to 35mm with a field of view of between 64 and 84 degrees, so a bit wider than the human eye. Now a standard lens of 50mm is the closest match to the perspective seen by the human eye. Fixed lenses are recommended as it lessens the risk of accidentally moving your focal length when handling your camera. For small objects, you will need a macro lens, which you can use a variable macro lens. Now, this is a more advanced technique, and the variable lens, as I said, can be tricky to maintain your focal length. I would suggest starting with 50mm or a wide-angle lens. I normally use a 28mm because I kind of have a variety of objects and some of them can be quite wide, but I will be using that when I demonstrate in the next chapter of taking a photo data set. Your camera needs to be in manual mode as you need complete control of the camera settings. Any auto setting can make slight differences in between each image, such as exposure, which can ruin your data set. Now, the first thing we're going to do is change the ISO, which I just did to 100, which is the desired setting. The ISO is a term left over from the days of film cameras. It is the sensitivity of the film, well, now digital image plane, to light. When you increase the ISO, it lets more light in, but it creates noise in the images, which reduces their quality. Setting it at 100 is just another way to create the best images possible. I am now going to change the aperture, also known as the f-stop, to f8, and now f11, which is the recommended aperture for photogrammetry. I prefer f11 as I like to have a larger f-stop. I will talk more about this in a few minutes when I discuss diffraction. Next is the exposure, which is the amount of light let into the camera as represented in seconds. Now the light in the room has been dimmed to film this little screenshot, so this exposure will be a bit longer than what I normally use of 0.5 to 0.6 seconds. As I increase the time of the exposure, you can see how the light affects the overall image. It is tempting to get the image as well lit as possible and to go a bit overboard with the length of exposure. But you need to keep an eye for overexposure as the images will need to have a good amount of contrast for getting a detailed texture. It is best to take a few test shots at different exposures to see what works best before you're starting your photo set.
When photographing objects in photogrammetry and with just photography in general, there's a balance between depth of field and image sharpness. Now, these two are not the same thing. Depth of field is how much of the image is in focus, not how sharp that focus is. Now, large apertures have small f-stops, which produce a shallow, small depth of field. Smaller apertures, which confusingly have a larger f-stop, have a deeper, larger depth of field. Now, lens diffraction occurs within these smaller apertures. Lens diffraction is a softening of the sharpness due to the light being diffracted or dispersed when passing through a smaller aperture.
It's a bit hard to conceptualize diffraction, so I'll go over it with this diagram. Now, diffraction is all about light waves and how they interact with the camera itself. Light is like any other wave. It interacts with the environment around it. Now, the aperture lets light into the camera and directs it towards the image plane where the image is captured. On the top left diagram, the large aperture lets the light pass through with little interference, and the light waves run parallel to the image plane, hitting it evenly. Now, next to it on the top right diagram, you can see that the smaller aperture forces the light through, and it bends around the corners as it passes through. This creates a curved wave pattern that looks a lot like the Wi-Fi icon. Now, this curved pattern hits the image plane with the top of the curve hitting first, as seen in this bottom diagram. Now, I'll enlarge it a little bit. Here is a bar on the side that shows how the light spreads across the image plane. It fades out from the center, creating a blurred focus on the edges. Now, examples can be seen in this really good article on diffraction that I have put in the links, and we'll give you a little bit more information on it.
F11, F8 apertures are suggested because most objects and buildings do not need deeper depth of fields. Also, it lessens the time needed for exposure, because the longer the exposure, the more risk that your objects move and make the photograph out of focus. Now, however, a balance can be made with proper conditions and understanding the science to get an image that suits your needs. It's really, in the end, just a trade-off between depth of field and overall sharpness. If the photographing workflow is created to handle this trade-off effectively, there can be minimal effects. On the Agisoft help form, it is suggested that if the object is stabilized and the camera is on a stable tripod, the risk of diffraction increases. Also, images should be checked at 200 times magnification when processed. Now, this is a much more advanced kind of area of photography, but it is important to kind of understand why we use F11 and F8. But you can see some of my work using those larger f-stops in our little tiny shiny photogrammetry lesson series, which we have a link over in the corner to. Next time, we will be talking about actually taking your images within...
Do you want to do like an ultra select on, and that was camera spaces, and then another do the full video, or do you think it's too much?
No, I think that's fine.
Okay, so.
So that was the camera basic, guys, and I'm afraid that's the end of this video. But in our next video, we will be talking about how to now take the pictures now that you've finished your settings. So I'll see you next time, guys. Thank you.